Yes, brother.
Who is the Antichrist and when it will come and who will fight with him? Can you enlighten on this?
Well, that was the question Islamically, who is the Antichrist and who will fight? There are various hadith talking about Dajjal. Dajjal will come and Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, will come again. He's been raised up alive by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in his second coming, he will fight against his Dajjal. And the various hadith talking about the Dajjal, that he'll be one-eyed, etc. So many people have given their own views who the Dajjal will be. So there are hadiths talking about the Dajjal. So surely before the world ends, this Dajjal will come. He'll be born. Isa alayhi salam will come again. He will see to it that he kills this Dajjal. Mehdi salam will come. And Khilafah will be established. So all these are there. So this is basically talking about the Dajjal, where there are various hadiths talking about it.
Is the Dajjal related to Jews? From Jews?
No, see, many things what is mentioned in the Bible may have also been mentioned in the Quran. What is mentioned in the Quran is also mentioned in the Bible. We agree it is correct. But there are many things which are mentioned there in the Bible which is not mentioned in the Quran. So it comes in the Mubah category, optional. But there are some things which are mentioned in the Bible which is again in the Quran and Sahih Hadith that we don't have to agree at all. So whenever you read any other scripture, whether it be the Bible, whether it be the Veda or any other religious scripture, there are three categories. One is what matches with Quran and Sahih Hadith. Whatever matches with Quran and Sahih Hadith, we have to follow it and we agree it is correct. What goes against the Quran and Hadith, we say it is wrong. What does not go against matches comes in Mubah category. May be right, may be wrong. So there are things also mentioned about Antichrist in the Bible, that there will be 666 mentioned, 666. You know, all these things are there. So whatever matches with the Quran, we agree. What is against the Quran, we disagree. What is optional, may be right, may be wrong. Hope that answers the question.
Yeah, yeah. Because I'm happy. I'm a Muslim, that's what makes me happy, and that's the truth.
Can we have the next question from a non-Muslim sister from this mic?
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Nai. My non-Muslim friend, I'm asking this question on behalf of her. She attended your Universal Brotherhood Conference and she really respects you. She believes in one God, but she is born in a Hindu family. So she thinks that whom she calls Brahma is what we call Kali. So as long as he is following her religion, she should get salvation. Then how can we convince her that the only accepted religion to God is Islam? Thank you.
Sister posed a question. One of our Hindu friends had come for my talk in Shah Alam, Universal Brotherhood, and she liked the lecture, but she said that who she considers Brahma as God is same as Khalik, so can she go to Jannah? If you read the Hindu scriptures, if you read Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3, one of the attributes given to God is Brahma. Brahma is called as the creator God. We Muslims have got no objection if someone says Almighty God is creator. If you translate creator into Arabic, it becomes Khalik. So we Muslims have got no objection if someone says Almighty God is creator or Khalik or Brahma. But if someone says Brahma is Almighty God who has got four heads and on each head is a crown, we Muslims take strong objection to it because you're going against Svetasita Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19, which says, Nachasya Pratima Asti, of that God there is no Pratima. Pratima in Sanskrit means an image, a photograph, a painting, a picture, a portrait, a sculpture, a statue, an idol. So the Hindu scriptures as well as the Vedas, Yajurveda chapter 32 verse number 3 says, Nachasya Pratima Asti, of that God there is no image, there is no photograph, there is no painting, there is no picture, there is no sculpture, there is no idol. So the moment you give an image to God, that means it is not the true God. And in the Hindu scriptures, I'd given the talk in Johor, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the world religious scriptures. In the Hindu scriptures, it prophesizes the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 5 to 8, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 10 to 27, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 1, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 21 to 23, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read the Kuntab Suktas, Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, verse number 1 to 14, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I can give references from Hindu scriptures. Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 6. Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 7, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is called as the one who praises Ahmad in several places. In Yajurved chapter 31, verse number 18. In Rigved, book number 8, hymn number 6, verse number 10. In Atharvaved, book number 8, hymn number 5, verse number 16. In Atharvaved, book number 20, hymn number 126, verse number 14. He is called as Nara Shansa. Nar means man, Shansa means praises, one who praises. If you translate Nara Shansa into Arabic, it becomes Muhammad. He is named as Muhammad Narashansa in several places in Hindu scriptures. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 13, verse number 3. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 18, verse number 9. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 106, verse number 4. Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 142, verse number 3. Rigved, book number 2, hymn number 3, verse number 2. Rigved, book number 5, hymn number 5, verse number 2. Rigved, book number 7, hymn number 2, verse number 2. Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 100, verse number 3. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse number 37. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse 57. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 31. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 2. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 19. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 42. I can go on and giving references only of Hindu scriptures about the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He is even prophesied as Kalki Avatar. If you read Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 5, 7, 11, 15, it says that the last and final messenger, his father's name shall be Vishnu Yas, that is servant of God, Abdullah, which was the name of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's father. His mother's name will be Sumati, which means peace, serenity. In Arabic, Amina, which was the name of the mother of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He'll be born in the village of Sambala, that is the village of peace and serenity, Makkah. He'll be born in the family of the chief of village of Sambala. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in the family of Quraysh. It says he'll be born on 12th day of Madhav, 12th Rabbi Awwal. He will have four friends, the first for Khulafa Rashidin. There are so many prophecies. So if she's a good Hindu, she should believe in one God who has got no idol and no image. You should believe in the last and final messenger, the Kalki Avatar Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you.
Let me tell you about my happiness. I get my happiness from Islam. It makes me kind and a better human.
Good evening, everyone, and good evening, Dr. Nayak. Today, I am a human speaking on behalf of humanity. Now, Dr. Nayak, since you were...
Can we have your name, please?
Yeah, I am Chirag. At least don't ask my religion. Dr. Nayak, since you were born maybe in a Muslim family, you were prescribed with your religion. Now, that is why today you are endorsing it, maybe. If you would have been born in a Hindu family, it could have been possible that today this religion would have been on Hinduism. This, I feel, is an extreme case of ethnocentrism, wherein you feel your religion, culture, beliefs, and ideas are supreme. That is why you said that Sikhism or Arya Samaj or whatever religion that abandons idol worship is supported by you too. According to me, we should be discussing a larger religion of humanity and not keep juggling here. Any comments or justification, sir?
Very good question. He says that because I was born in a Muslim family, that's the reason I'm endorsing Islam. Maybe if I was born in a Hindu family, I would be endorsing Hinduism. And I'm supporting Arya Samaj and Sikhism because it matches my view and I'm juggling around. I should rather speak about broader aspect. Very good question.
Yes.
Brother, I agree with you. Till the age of 19, I was a Muslim only because my father was a Muslim. After the age of 19, when I started studying about comparative religion, now I'm a Muslim by choice. And believe me, if you can point out any other religion to me better than Islam, I'm ready to accept that religion today. Today.
Sir, I'm endorsing the religion of humanity.
Brother, I'll come to it.
Yeah.
I'll come to it.
Yeah.
I'm telling
anyone proves to me logically, scientifically, any other religion better than Islam, I am ready to accept it. You are talking about humanity. Who wrote this religion, humanity? Mahatma Gandhi? Who wrote it? You know, a Muslim cannot be a good Muslim unless he's a good human being.
That every religion says,
Brother, let me complete my answer.
Yes, sir.
Are you here to hear my answer or are you here to give your views?
I would like to have a healthy discussion and reach to a logical conclusion.
This is not a debate session.
Not at all. I never said.
So listen to my answer. After my answer, you can give your comment.
Okay, please.
Let me finish my answer. Keep on interjecting. That means you listen to my answer.
Carry on.
Listen carefully.
Yeah.
Something is going, Mahabharata is going in your mind. How will you listen?
When please carry on.
When you read out your question, did I interrupt?
Please carry on.
Did I interrupt?
You did not. Please carry on.
Everything writing down, coming, asking question.
I'm giving
the reply. Listen, this is my reply.
I'm listening.
So why are you commenting?
Please carry on, sir. Please justify. Tell me your answer.
If you listen to my answer, you'll understand. Otherwise, all this, more than 100,000 people will understand, yet you'll have the same question. I'm a medical doctor. A person can't concentrate on two different things. Listen to the answer. After the answer is over, no problem. So what you have to realize, you're talking about humanity. First you said, don't ask my religion. Then you're saying, I'm endorsing humanity. First of all, you're ashamed to identify your view. Then you're talking about humanity. I'm asking the question, who wrote this book called Humanity? Is there any book? Is there any guidelines of humanity? I'm telling you, a Muslim cannot be a Muslim until he's a good human being. Every religion doesn't say that. I'm sorry to say that. You have not studied the other religions. I can give a talk. I can give you quotations from the Vedas, quotations from Hindu scriptures, quotations from the Bible, which goes against humanity. I'm not here to criticize any religion. If you have not studied any religion, please don't say anything which you have no knowledge of. Quran says, Fas'alu ahal zikri in kuntum ta'alamun. Surah Nahl chapter 16 verse 43, Surah Anbiya chapter 21 verse number 7. You are not a student of comparative religion. So please don't make comments without knowing. I can give you quotations from the Bible against humanity. I challenge you to point out a single verse of the Quran, a single teaching of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, which is against humanity. So don't tell me every religion says that. Sorry, your knowledge is very weak. What I'm trying to tell you, humanity means, okay, you're in standard two. I'm talking about not only passing school, not only graduation, you have to become postgraduate. Islam means higher level. Only humanity is low level. No Muslim can be a good Muslim unless he's a good human. I challenge you to point out a single teaching of Islam which is against humanity. You may not be knowing the logical background, the logical reason why Islam has prescribed that teaching, and you may think it is against humanity. Like I would say, oh, doctor is giving me injection, it is poking me. But that injection is good for you. No, doctor is cutting up my tummy. He's cutting up my tummy to save your life. So doctor knows, you don't know. If I have two choices, okay, passing standard two or three, or doing post-graduation, I would prefer post-graduation. Why only standard two and three? Humanity is good, but Islam is far superior than that. Regarding your question, I am endorsing Islam because I was born in a Muslim family. I told you, I challenge you, if anyone proves to me any other religion, I have studied most of the major religions. And I think Islam is the most logical, the best religion for humanity. It is the only religion which has the solution for humanity. Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 19, Inna deena indallahi al-Islam. The only religion acceptable in the sight of Almighty God is Islam. And for your information, your argument is so weak. Do you know, out of more than 30 scholars that we have, from different parts of the world, more than 10, they were not born in a Muslim family. Do you know that? I'd like you to answer this question. Do you know that? Out of 30 people speaking from the stage, more than 10, they were not born Muslim. Do you know that?
Sir, I attached maybe.
I'm asking you a question. Do you know that?
No,
yes
I don't
or no?
Know that.
So that means the whole argument falls down. Out of the 30 people speaking from different parts of the world, more than 10 are from America, 4 are from Canada, few are from UK, we are from Malaysia, we have a couple from Saudi Arabia, from UAE, from Somalia, from Sudan, and more than 10, they were born in non-Muslim families. They grew up. Some accepted Islam in the teenage, some accepted Islam in the 20s, some in 30s. And Allah gave them hidayah. They are Muslims by choice. So your logic that because we are born in Muslim family, therefore I'm endorsing. These people weren't born in Muslim family. They were born in Christian family. They were born in non-Muslim family. Yet they're endorsing Islam. Why? Because they have studied.
She thinks that whom she calls Brahma is what we call Khalik. So as long as he is following her religion, she should get salvation. Then how can we convince her that the only accepted religion to God is Islam? Thank you.
Sister has posed a question. One of her Hindu friends had come for my talk in Shah Alam, Universal Brotherhood. And she liked the lecture, but she said that who she considers Brahma as God is same as Khalik, so can she go to Jannah? If you read the Hindu scriptures, if you read Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3, one of the attributes given to God is Brahma. Brahma is called as the creator God. We Muslims have got no objection if someone says Almighty God is creator. If you translate creator into Arabic, it becomes Khalik. So we Muslims have got no objection if someone says Almighty God is creator or Khalik or Brahma. But if someone says Brahma is Almighty God who has got 4 heads and on each head is a crown, we Muslims take strong objection to it because you're going against Shvetashvatara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19, which says, Na achasya pratima asti, of that God there is no pratima. Pratima in Sanskrit means an image, a photograph, a painting, a picture, a portrait, a sculpture, a statue, an idol. So, the Hindu scriptures as well as the Vedas, Yajurveda chapter 32 verse number 3 says, Na achasya pratima asti, of that God there is no image, there is no photograph, there is no painting, there is no picture, there is no sculpture, there is no idol. So the moment you give an image to God, that means it is not the true God. And in the Hindu scriptures, I had given a talk in Johor Bahru, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the world religious scriptures. In the Hindu scriptures, it prophesizes the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 5 to 8, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 10 to 27, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 1, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 21 to 23, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read the Kuntap Suktas, Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, verse number 1 to 14, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I can give references from Hindu scriptures. Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 20.
Yes, brother.
Who is the Antichrist? And when it will come and who will fight with him? Can you enlighten on that?
Well, that's the question Islamically, who's the Antichrist and who'll fight? There are various hadith talking about Dajjal. Dajjal who'll come. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, will come again. He's been raised up alive by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in his second coming, he will fight against this Dajjal. And the various hadith talking about the Dajjal, that he'll be one-eyed, etc. So many people have given their own views who the Dajjal will be. So there are hadith talking about the Dajjal. So surely before the world ends, this Dajjal will come, he'll be born. Isa alayhi salam will come again. He will see to it that he kills this Dajjal. Mehdi alayhi salam will come and Khilafah will be established. So all these are there. So this is basically talking about the Dajjal, where there are various hadiths talking about it.
Is Dajjal related to Jews? Is it from Jews?
No. See, many things what is mentioned in the Bible may have also been mentioned in the Quran. What is mentioned in the Quran is also mentioned in the Bible. We agree it is correct. But there are many things which are mentioned there in the Bible which is not mentioned in the Quran. So it comes in the Mubah category, optional. But there are some things which are mentioned in the Bible which is again the Quran and Sahih Hadith that we don't have to agree at all. So whenever you read any other scripture, whether it be the Bible, whether it be the Veda or any other religious scripture, there are 3 categories. One is what matches with Quran and Sahih Hadith. Whatever matches with Quran and Sahih Hadith, we have to follow it and we agree it is correct. What goes against the Quran and Hadith, we say it is wrong. What does not go against matches comes in Mubah category. Maybe right, maybe wrong. So there are things also mentioned about Antichrist in the Bible, that there will be 666 mentioned, 666. You know, all these things are there. So whatever matches with the Quran, we agree. What is against the Quran, we disagree. What is optional, maybe right, maybe wrong. Hope that answers the question.
Yeah. Because I'm happy, I'm a Muslim, that's what makes me happy, and that's the truth.
Can we have the next question from a non-Muslim sister from this mic?
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Naik. My non-Muslim friend, I am asking this question on behalf of her. She attended your Universal Brotherhood Conference and she really respects you. She believes in one God, but she is born in a Hindu family. So she...
Today.
Sir, I am endorsing the religion of humanity.
Brother, I'll come to it.
Yeah.
I'll come to it.
Yeah.
I'm telling anyone, prove to me logically, scientifically, any other religion better than Islam, I am ready to accept it. You're talking about humanity. Who wrote this religion, humanity? Mahatma Gandhi? Who wrote it? You know, a Muslim cannot be a good Muslim unless he's a good human being.
That every religion says, every brother, religion says.
Brother, let me complete my answer.
Yes, sir.
Are you here to hear my answer or are you here to give your views?
I would like to have a healthy discussion and reach brother, to a logical conclusion.
This is not a debate session.
Not at all. I never said.
So listen to my answer. After my answer, you can give your comment.
Okay, please.
Let me finish my answer. Keep on interjecting. That means you listen to my answer.
Carry on.
Listen carefully.
Yeah.
Something is going, Mahabharata is going in your mind. How will you listen?
When please
you
carry on.
When you read out your question, did I interrupt?
Please carry on.
Did I interrupt?
You did not. Please carry on.
Everything writing down, coming, asking question.
I'm
giving the reply. Listen, this is my reply.
What, I'm listening.
So why are you commenting?
Please carry on, sir. Please justify. Tell me your answer.
If you listen to my answer, you'll understand. Otherwise, all this more than 100,000 people will understand, yet you'll have the same question. I'm a medical doctor. A person can't concentrate on two different things. Listen to the answer. After the answer is over, no problem. So what you have to realize, you're talking about humanity. First you said, don't ask my religion. Then you're saying, I'm endorsing humanity. First of all, you're ashamed to identify your view. Then you're talking about humanity. I'm asking the question, who wrote this book called Humanity? Is there any book? Is there any guidelines of humanity? I'm telling you, a Muslim cannot be a Muslim until he's a good human being. Every religion doesn't say that. I'm sorry to say that. You have not studied the other religions. I can give a talk. I can give you quotations from the Vedas, quotations from Hindu scriptures, quotations from the Bible, which goes against humanity. I'm not here to criticize any religion. If you have not studied any religion, please don't say anything which you have no knowledge of. Quran says, Fas'alu ahli zikri in kuntum ta'alamun. Surah Nahl chapter 16 verse 43, Surah Anbiya chapter 21 verse number 6, Atharvaved book number 20, hymn number 21 verse number 7, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is called as the one who praises Ahmad in several places. In Yajurved chapter 31 verse number 18, in Rigved book number 8, hymn number 6 verse number 10, in Atharvaved book number 8, hymn number 5 verse number 16, in Atharvaved book number 20, hymn number 126, verse number 14. He is called as Nara Shansa. Nar means man, Shansa means praises, one who praises. If you translate Nara Shansa into Arabic, it becomes Muhammad. He is named as Muhammad Nara Shansa in several places in Hindu scriptures. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 13, verse number 3. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 18, verse number 9. In Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 106, verse number 4. Rigved, book number 1, hymn number 142, verse number 3. Rigved, book number 2, hymn number 3, verse number 2. Rigved, book number 5, hymn number 5, verse number 2. Rigved, book number 7, hymn number 2, verse number 2. Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 100, verse number 3. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse number 37. Yajurved, chapter number 20, verse 57. Yajurved, chapter number 21, verse number 31. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 2. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 19. Yajurved, chapter number 28, verse number 42. I can go on and giving references only of Hindu scriptures about the last and final messenger Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He is even prophesied as Kalki Avatar. If you read Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 5, 7, 11, 15, it says that the last and final messenger, his father's name shall be Vishnu Yas, that is servant of God, Abdullah, which was the name of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's father. His mother's name will be Sumati, which means peace, serenity. In Arabic, Amina, which was the name of the mother of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He'll be born in the village of Sambala, that is the village of peace and serenity, Makkah. He'll be born in the family of the chief of village of Sambala. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in the family of Quraysh. It says he'll be born on 12th day of Madhav, 12th Rabbi Awwal. He will have four friends.
the first four Khulafa Rashidin. There are so many prophecies. So if she's a good Hindu, she should believe in one God who has got no idol and no image. She should believe in the last and final messenger, the Kalki Avatar Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you.
Let me tell you about my happiness. I get my happiness from Islam. It makes me kind and a better human.
Good evening, everyone, and good evening, Dr. Nayak. Today, I am a human speaking on behalf of humanity. Now, Dr. Nayak, since you were...
Can we have your name, please?
Yeah, I am Chirag. At least don't ask my religion. Dr. Nayak, since you were born maybe in a Muslim family, you were prescribed with your religion. Now, that is why today you are endorsing it maybe. If you would have been born in a Hindu family, it could have been possible that today this religion would have been on Hinduism. This, I feel, is an extreme case of ethnocentrism, wherein you feel your religion, culture, beliefs, and ideas are supreme. That is why you said that Sikhism or Arya Samaj or whatever religion that abandons idol worship is supported by you too. According to me, we should be discussing a larger religion of humanity and not keep juggling here. Any comments or justification, sir?
Very good question. He says that because I was born in a Muslim family, that's the reason I'm endorsing Islam. Maybe if I was born in a Hindu family, I would be endorsing Hinduism. And I'm supporting Arya Samaj and Sikhism because it matches my view. And I'm juggling around, I should rather speak about broader aspect. Very good question.
Yes.
Brother, I agree with you. Till the age of 19, I was a Muslim only because my father was a Muslim. After the age of 19, when I started studying about comparative religion, now I'm a Muslim by choice. And believe me, if you can point out any other religion to me better than Islam, I'm ready to accept that religion today.